Hello everyone and welcome to the Winecast. This cast is about a grape that's been getting some play on a couple of other casts that I've done on individual grape varietals, mostly because it's apparent to those other grapes. But more and more, Cabernet Franc, the featured grape on this cast, is getting the attention it deserves in its own right, and a quick cast on this grape seemed appropriate. So let's have a look at Cab Franc. Though Cab Franc's origins are still obscure, it does seem to have come from the Basque country that now straddles northern Spain and southern France. Cab Franc's own parents are still in doubt, but what's well known now, thanks to genetic analysis, is that Cab Franc is a parent of Merlot with a grape called Magdalene Noire de Charente, Cabernet Sauvignon with Sauvignon Blanc, and Carmenere with a grape called Gros Cabernet. By a wide margin, France is home to the majority of the world's Cabernet Franc plantings, with Italy, the U.S., Hungary, Chile, and South Africa following. As of 2010, Cab Franc is the 17th most widely planted grape varietal in the world. Cab Franc is an early ripener, ready for harvest a full week or two before Cabernet Sauvignon usually is. The tendency to ripen early helps it to do well in cool climates that have shorter growing seasons. When grown in cooler areas, the aromas and flavors feature tart red fruit, think cranberry, along with herbal notes of tea, tobacco, and a characteristic grassy aroma, often described as green bell pepper. In warmer climates, the red fruits get softer, so think raspberries, and the non-fruit aromas become more floral, and there's also a diminishing of the bell pepper characteristic. That particular aroma is the product of compounds called methoxypyrazines, present in Cabernet Franc, but also in closely related grapes like Merlot, Cab Sauv, Carmenere, and Sauvignon Blanc. These compounds disappear with sun exposure and as the grape ripens, so they can be controlled through effective management of the grapevine canopy to allow grapes to get the sun exposure they need, as well as through decisions about how long to allow the grapes to remain on the vine. These components aren't unique to grapes, incidentally, and occur in lots of other things, including, obviously, bell peppers, but also, fun fact, in ladybugs. In fact, ladybug infestations in wine regions as far from each other as Burgundy and Ontario, Canada, have been linked to atypical green pyrazine-y odors in the finished wines. Ooh. Cab Franc tends toward medium alcohol and tannin, and the tannins especially can be at the low end of medium. Acidity in wines made from this grape tends to sit at the high end of medium and beyond, making it a great wine to drink with food, especially when done in a cool climate style. Cab Franc has a special relationship with Bordeaux, where it's been a part of that region's wine culture for centuries. It's a particularly important blending partner in the Libournais area of Bordeaux's right bank that features the appellations of Saint-Emilion, Pomerol, and Fronsac, as well as their satellites. Cab Franc's tendency to ripen early has been a source of security for Bordeaux winemakers. In the event that later ripening Cabernet Sauvignon be damaged by bad weather while it's still on the vine, producers can fall back on already harvested Cab Franc and give it a larger role in their blends. Despite its importance, Cab Franc is seldom the dominant grape in a Bordeaux blend, the major exception being wines produced by Château Cheval Blanc, one of the most highly regarded and ranked chateaux in Saint-Emilion, where Cab Franc is blended with a smaller amount of Merlot to create the final wine. Interestingly, it was a bottle of the 1961 Cheval Blanc that was the prized possession of the thoroughly unlovable Miles from the movie and book Sideways. Though it's debatable how much Miles actually dislikes Merlot as such, he openly trashes Cab Franc in one scene and calls it something that he's never come to expect greatness from. Oh, the irony. Cab Franc also has a special relationship to France's Loire Valley. Farther north than Bordeaux, the Loire plays to Cab Franc's strengths as an early ripener and cool climate-friendly grape, and it's here more than in any other region of the world that Cab Franc comes into its own as a single varietal. The Loire also showcases Cab Franc's versatility, as it's featured not just as a red still wine, but as a traditional method sparkling wine, called a crémant, and as a rosé. There are a number of appellations that make Cab Franc-driven wines in the Loire, but for quality and purity of expression, look for wines from Chinon, Bourgogne, and Saint-Nicolas de Bourgogne, where the wines must contain at least 90% Cab Franc and are often made as 100% examples of the varietal. If you're looking for varietal Cab Franc outside of France, start with the U.S., where on the West Coast it tends to be made in the softer, more luscious, warm climate style. On the East Coast of the United States, Cab Franc is also found a home, especially in New York and Virginia. In New York, the cool climate helps bring out a decidedly old world feel to the wine. But in Virginia, which is hotter and more humid than New York, critics often see both cooler and warmer climate characteristics in Cab Franc. Cab Franc is made in several styles in Canada, but its most interesting expression might be as an ice wine in the Niagara Peninsula region. Finally, a lot of critics are getting excited about Cabernet Franc's potential as a varietal in Hungary, and if you can find some Hungarian Cab Franc, it would definitely be worth checking out. Thanks for joining me for another Winecast. As always, if you found the cast helpful and informative, please like and subscribe if you haven't already, and feel free to leave a comment, question, or suggestion below. I'm your host, The Unknown Winecaster, and I'm out. Enjoy the grape, but always enjoy it responsibly.